Oh, that was a bad fade out. Hey, you're listening to the Ball Earth Skeptic Roundtable, episode number 3 on Wednesday, June 24, 2015. That was Hot Chip with Motion Sickness. And I'm joined as usual on the panel by David Weiss of Deep Inside the Rabbit Hole, who recommended that trendy little number. And I like that, David. That's a good pickup. How'd you find that one?
My son found it when he bought an album and it happened to be on it after he was giving me a lot of crap about the Earth not being flat.
Well, I really enjoyed that one. I just think I stuffed up the fade out, but that's all right. It's all a learning curve. And Matrix Decode, you've joined us again for episode 3. Thanks for taking the time.
Hey, John. Yeah, good to be here again. Looking forward to the show.
Good stuff, mate. Well, let me read out this little intro that I've got planned for our big special guest. Mark Sargent burst onto the flat Earth scene in mid-February when he released 8 short clues in 9 days, each one dealing with a distinct element of the flat Earth narrative. They quickly went viral, and before long, Sargent was appearing on numerous alternative media shows and podcasts, including Truth Frequency Radio, The High Side Chats, and lately even more mainstream outlets like Coast to Coast. A little over 4 months since he first appeared on the scene, Mark has now released 11 clues. He's completed 23 interviews, hosted 9 Strange World episodes, all of his own, and he now even has his own website at enclosedworld.com. Total YouTube views to date over 700,000 and counting. Mark's meteoric rise hasn't gone without criticism, and some of the other flat earthers out there have questioned his motivations and information, even prompting Mark to entitle one of his interviews, "Is Mark Sargent a Shill?" Despite all of this, he has helped to awaken thousands of people around the world to the fakery of NASA and the mysteries of the Earth on which we stand, including yours truly, Mark Sargent's Flat Earth Quiz, is what got me interested in all of this 3 or 4 months ago. So with all of that said, Mark, take yourself off mute and welcome to the Ball Earth Skeptic Roundtable.
Thanks very much for having me, guys. I am present and accounted for at 6 a.m. Colorado time.
Well, it's 10 p.m. here in Brisbane. You're speaking with Matrix Decode. They're live in Spain via London. And, of course, David Weiss of Deep Inside the Rabbit Hole in New York. So we're on all corners of the plane today, Mark. And I've been getting the feedback. People heard that you were coming on the show, and they've been just as excited as I am. So with all of that said, we'd best get straight into giving you a chance to just introduce yourself to those who aren't already familiar. Do you want to give us a basic background to the Flat Earth clues and the feedback that you've been getting?
Sure. The basic background of the Flat Earth clues is I started out as a debunker last summer. Like many of the people that are going down the rabbit hole this time. And during the summer, I thought I could knock this thing out in a weekend. You know, I looked at the topic, you know, the flat earth, and thought it was a joke, thought it was ridiculous. And I said, okay, I'll just disprove it and be on my way. And it turned out to be a Pandora's box. And so, you know, fast forward to February, I'm banging my head on the desk saying, why can't I prove it's a globe? And woke up in the middle of the night, second week of February, with a narrative in my head, and sat down and just started typing out the script for Flat Earth Clues, which I just had to get it out. I just, you know what, this thing needs some structure and clarity, and I think I've got it. And once I started, you know, I wasn't even sure when I first did it. I thought I was going to do the introduction of maybe one clue and be done with it. But by the time I got to the bird wall, I realized I was in for the duration, and just kept cranking them out one after another until I took a break after clue 7, the long haul, then you know, finished them up. But I never, and when I started out, I did everything you're not supposed to do on YouTube to avoid traction, which was, you know, I didn't allow ratings, I didn't allow comments, I didn't monetize it, and I didn't think, it was like, you know what, I just put it out there, good, it's out of my head, I don't have to deal with it. And now the phone calls just started coming in, and everyone wanted to talk about it, to the point where I you know, interview after interview, and I know, again, I know I say the same things in the interview, which is, we'll deal with that later, but yeah, here we are. I had to create a website, which I didn't think I'd have to do, called enclosedworld.com. Truth Frequency gave me my own show, which was great. I have a little newspaper column up in Vancouver, Canada. They wanted to do something with me, and so I'm just kind of rolling with it at this point, and taking this wherever it leads me. Guys, still there?
Yeah, John seems to.
Did he drop off? No big deal. But yeah, so that's where I am, to the point where now it's every day when I go on YouTube, it is amazing. I have to literally, you know, I don't even type in Flat Earth Clues. I just type in Flat Earth, set the filter to, you know, one day or 24 hours, and it's amazing the amount of stuff that's being put out there. It's not me, you know, by any stretch. I mean, yeah, I'm out there, you know, I put out a lot of stuff, but the amount of stuff that other people are putting out is incredible. Jaronism is putting out a whole bunch of stuff. You know, Matt Boylan, you know, the legend that won't do interviews. he's getting massive amounts of hits, and it's incredible to watch. Eric Dubé's got a lot of neat stuff. But what's neat for me is watching the people that are going in as debunkers. You know, they're saying up front, it's like, I'm going to debunk this. And they go in, and I'm warning people now. It's like, look, it's a Pandora's box. You don't want to do it. If you like your ignorance, if you like your globe, don't go down this road, because you're going to get sucked in like me. And I'm watching, you know, how many times are we going to see this now, where even those people from that roundtable that was last week, I guarantee some of those people are going to be pro plane before this is over, because they all start out the same way. They go in and they say, it's like the tar pits, like La Brea tar pits, where you see a debunker going down and you say, oh, I'm going to help him. I can debunk it because he had problems. And you get pulled in too. And that's how I started. So it's like, look, if it hasn't been debunked by now, after 4 months, there is no magic bullet for this thing. No one's going to bring this thing down. It has got a life of its own, and it is a joy to watch at this point.
Mark, I think I disappeared there momentarily. Can you guys see me again?
Yeah, we can.
I do apologize for that. For those who aren't aware, we should just point out the roundtable that you refer to there, Mark, is the We'll Do It Live roundtable trying to debunk us last week. You tuned in for that one, did you?
Yeah. I watched the whole thing, and they ran into – I'm watching it. I'm just shaking my head going, look, you guys don't know. I was in your shoes. Don't tell me you're going to debunk this now. If the internet hive mind has not done it in 4 months, you're not going to do it. The only people that have a shot at this at all is NASA, and they're not talking. And eventually, they're going to have to address this. Because I'll not to pick on that roundtable, but the points that they didn't cover, you know, they weren't going to talk about Apollo, not going to talk about the Van Allen radiation belts. I've got 5 points that absolutely cannot be touched. I love the fact that they put up the Apollo 17 picture on screen, and they talked about it for 45 seconds, and then just, you know, moved past it. And who was the host of that show? The one with the heart with the world inside it.
One of the co-panelists is called Press Reset Earth, and he uses the little blue marble turn into a love heart. And
yeah,
I think he does love the globe. I think there are a lot of people out there, Mark, who do love the globe, and it's going to be sad to see some of them have to eventually let go of the model. But over time, I think that's exactly what will happen. I need to go and just moderate the live chat for a moment, so I'll throw it to you there, David. Take it away.
Yeah, so, Mark, when I do a show called Deep Inside the Rabbit Hole, and people have been posting on my Facebook page, I mentioned this in the last show, yep. You know, check out this flat earth, check this out. And I would just delete the comments, and I even banned the users, and I refused to look. I absolutely refused. And then finally, somebody I trusted said, just, you have to check this out. And I believe it was one of your videos. I went through every video you did, and I'm just like, oh my God, this is got, you know, the fact that I'm even questioning it, you know, I don't even like to say today that I'm a flat earther, but if you said, hey, I'll give you $100,000 if you pick the right one, I'm going to pick the earth is not a ball.
Okay? That's a good way of saying it. I like that.
So, yeah. So it was just an amazing turnaround for me. And you know, I'll listen to anybody. I'll listen to, you know, what anyone has to say, and then I'm smart enough to take that information, look at it myself, and say, all right, what pocket does this fall in? Does it fall into flat earth, ball earth, or undefined, you know, undeterminable?
Yeah. The five stages of acceptance really apply to this topic more than just about anything, and that is the first one, and I know that a couple guys have already talked, you know, done it on their YouTube thing. The first one's always denial, and that is, it's ludicrous. It's ludicrous. It's ridiculous. We shouldn't even be talking about this. Followed by anger, immediately. It's like, how dare you? And I've had people on, you know, on call-in stuff that say this, like, how dare you tell me the world isn't what you say it, what I think it is. Followed by bargaining. you know, where they're on the fence, followed by depression, and then finally they sink into it. And yeah, you're absolutely right. The story you said is the same thing that just about everybody that's interviewed me has said. It's like they get to, it's like, no, there's no way we're actually talking about this. To where now we, you know, it's become a very, you know, in the conspiracy world or alternative media world, it's become a legitimate topic. How does this happen?
It's absolutely amazing. And what I noticed literally yesterday is I work on a Mac. My desktop is the globe Earth. I just realized that yesterday. I'm looking at it. I'm like, everywhere I look, I went to the movies, and every preview had a globe Earth spinning in it. You know, in the movies, there's globes. It's just everywhere. And now when I look at a globe, I'm like, that's absolutely ridiculous.
Yeah, it's the greatest con of all time. And I don't want to get too much into biblical stuff because, you know, I know we try to remain somewhat religious neutral. But, you know, people have asked me all the time, is this the great deception? Is this the great deception? I was going, well, if it isn't, I don't know what's a better example, because what trick that everybody falls for. Doesn't matter how rich you are, how famous you are, you know, how politically connected you are. Everybody fell for it, and it's brilliant from that standpoint. Nobody questioned it. 99.99% of the people. I mean, really, is the Matrix argument, you know, not to go down the prison road, but you know, a world which you can't define because it was always already handed to you. So you believed what you were told, you know, as a child. It's the greatest con ever.
Yeah, people have been asking, a lot of people ask the same question, which is, you know, if it is flat, why the great deception? And in my mind, you know, I'd like to hear your opinion on this. The answer is very simple. You know, we're aware, you know, in the people's media, which I like to call it, rather than the corporate government-controlled propaganda media, that they are trying to control us through all sorts of draconian laws and, you know, all these false flags and everything. But the one thing they wouldn't be able to control is if we knew there was more very close by. You know, I don't, and to keep that truth from us is really the key to controlling the people. Because if we found out that there is something beyond the Antarctic ice wall, there's no stopping the human curiosity.
No. Yeah, and again, I do not, you know, I agree in some parts with Matt Boylan's model, which I think what you're talking about there, and that is, can we get from one world to the next? You know, if there's another world like this on the other, you know, next to us, can we get to it? But let's go down that road, and that is, yeah, if that was found out, and let me back up. You can't be the authority if you're not the authority, if you're not the highest power. And so from the authority standpoint, you're absolutely right. If it was found out that we had structure to this place, if it was built, regardless if there's a barrier or not, the human consciousness, human beings, they would be obsessed with it. Not everybody, of course, but there'd be a huge pilgrimage. Everyone would want to see it. Everyone would want to explore and get out and try to see. It's like, what, you know, there's more than this? You know, there's more than what we are right now, and people would branch out. And that is a big, big concern to the powers that be, the governments, the authorities, the super rich, the royals. You don't want people going down that road, and I'll throw it one more further from, you know, from a spirituality standpoint. You can't give, from a science government standpoint, if you give people, if you give all religions at the same time their holy grail, you are talking about reorganizing culture and our civilization as we know it. And it is a big pain in the ass. And they don't want to go down that road, you know, just from the paperwork side of things. Man, it would take decades to reorganize everything here. I think it still would be in a good way, but they just don't want to deal with it. So, you know, when they decided back in 1956 that it's all right, let's just keep this under wraps for as long as we can, I firmly believe that eventually, you know, they were drawing up contingency plans. It's like, okay, what happens when we can't hold on to this anymore? And I think that's where we are now. It's, for whatever reason, this groundswell, whatever, you know, want to call it grassroots, some people have, that's where we are now.
I have a question for you. And excuse me for not fully understanding your view, but do you believe, do you have a strong belief that we are either in a dome or not in a dome, or that there is an end to how far we could possibly go, or do you believe that, you know, it could go on endlessly?
Well, I think it does go on. I'm kind of a mix of the two. Matt and I have talked, and he believes, yeah, it's a plane that keeps going, and that there's more worlds like ours, you know, like an egg crate. But I believe, from a design standpoint, I'm just, you know, again, it's my opinion. People have said, you got to make sure you state it's your opinion. Fine, it's my opinion. But from a design standpoint, I think it's pretty sound, and that is, you wouldn't let a civilization like ours run amok. And I used to, yeah, I said one of my last interviews, I said, you know, it could be that, you know, they're treating us in here like a box of kittens, but really it's like a box of baby scorpions. You know, look adorable, but you don't want them just running all over the place because they can do a lot of damage. So I believe, yeah, that we are, there is a confinement here, but not necessarily from a sinister point of view. Again, I'm going to take the optimist side, the silver lining side, not from a sinister point of view, but that we are being held in, you know, for our own good, because we're not ready to go out. You know, again, we haven't evolved, you know, in my opinion.
I'm going to have to agree with you on that. You know, it's the same argument that, you know, globe ball Earth people believe, you know, the reason that the extraterrestrials aren't allowing us to, you know, go, you know, travel space is because we're not ready to, you know, to infect the rest of the cosmos, if you will. But it sure makes a lot more sense that, you know, instead of being incomprehensible light years away, they're just thousands of miles away. You know, a conventional plane, you know, with a big fuel tank could get us there. Which is incredible.
Yeah, the argument is that's been in science fiction for years. I mean, the day the Earth stood still from the 1950s, you know, where they came right out and said, look, humanity cannot be allowed to roam freely. You know, you guys would just start messing up everything like you messed up your own place. And I agree with that standpoint. But at the same time, I still think it is beneficial to us to get this out there, to get this message out there, because I think it ties everything together, makes us one big community, one big family, and we start to turn this place around.
While John's messing around in the chat, I want to just throw one of the biggest questions out there is how the pole stars work. And I have a thought. I've been thinking about it a lot, and I wanted to just throw it out there and see what you think. So we have our magnetic north, and we have all of the stars, whatever they are, circling around it. And if we do time-lapse photography, and I believe the North Star time-lapse photography is legitimate, it shows these circles, you know. But how would it work in the South Pole? And perhaps imagine this dome of stars circling around us, and from the north it's really easy to see, and from the south, you know, it would be so low on the horizon you couldn't see it. It goes past the vanishing point. But perhaps there's another, what I call it my puddle theory. You know, our sun has melted a puddle that we know as Earth, that the next puddle isn't far over that Antarctic ice wall. As Admiral Byrd, you know, said, he flew to a tropical paradise. Well, it couldn't have been that far if he made it, if that story is true. And perhaps when you look from the southern parts of our disk, our flat area, that you're seeing the pole star of another puddle, of another dome of stars that are rotating, you know, like egg beaters, where they're rotating in opposite directions and possibly have some merging.
And, that's excellent. Have you ever done programming before?
I have not. I cannot model that.
What you're pretty much describing is what we've been doing in programming since 2004, which is called an instance. And really, what I try to explain, what you're explaining, I'll boil it down even further. But I like your thing, because your thing is more organic. And if people want to go with that, hey, great. What I try to tell people is, like, look, if this is a giant planetarium, as far as when it comes to the stars, you don't have to think of it like a singular planetarium. What I say is, okay, think of one, then think of two planetariums underneath the same structure. And that is, you got, you know, one at one end, one at the other end. So if you have a person standing at one end and another person staying at the other end, technically they think they're looking at the exact same stars, but in reality they're looking at two completely different projections or two different, you know, renderings of the same thing. You know, but since you can only be at one place at the same, you know, at one time, you can't prove to the other person that you're not looking at the exact same stars. It's like, oh yeah, I'm looking at Orion's belt, and you're on your cell phone with somebody else saying, oh yeah, I'm looking at Orion's belt too, but you're not looking at the same Orion's belt. We do that in the software, especially in the entertainment industry, all day long. If anyone has any doubts, log into Warcraft. It's free now, by the way. And just look up at the sky. You can change what you see in the sky based on region. And I know it sounds too easy. It's like, oh, you're copying out with a programming reference. No, I'm not. Because if we're doing it here, then why would anyone else do anything different outside of us?
Well, can I just interject briefly there? I know, Mark, that you've got your dome model, and we'll get to that in a moment. Earth obviously has his puddle model, which he's a huge fan of.
Yeah.
What I want to spend some time doing first is looking at why we don't believe in the ball, because this is the Ball Earth Skeptic Roundtable, and this is a roundtable, so we'll throw to Matrix there. He's been very patient. Any questions for Mark Matrix?
Yeah, good to have you on the show, Mark.
Hey, nice seeing you again.
I mean, this subject, you know, it takes a lot of time to research and contemplate, and, you know, there's lots of layers to get through, and there's, you know, the amount of videos that are coming out these days. Like yourself, you've made a lot of videos, and you know, putting forth different fascinating aspects of the whole flat Earth subject. I mean, you know, it's such an important subject. You know, but, you know, this determines where we are, determines who we are, and it's such a fundamental part of the deception behind so many deceptions within science, or you know, what we're terming more now as scientism. And you know, it leads us to question and reevaluate everything, from like the Big Bang to evolution and Darwinism. I was wondering, what are your views on mainstream science, and has investigating this subject like changed your views?
Yeah. You know, some people have asked me, you know, as far as mainstream science goes, because that is one of the big arguments you'll get at you, because there's such a huge body of work, especially in astronomy, and I mean, not so much with astrophysics, but definitely in astronomy, that's covered hundreds of years, and people said, well, you know, is Einstein wrong with relativity, and is Stephen Hawking wrong, Carl Sagan wrong? And are you saying that these guys are wrong? You know, how dare you? What arrogance? I'm going, no, this has nothing to do with arrogance. You know, these were brilliant men, to be sure. But at the same time, their foundation, if the foundation they were basing their work on was wrong or flawed, then everything they did was just tacked on the top of flawed work to begin with. So when it comes to mainstream science, unfortunately, the doctrines that have been put out there for a long, long time, they're all based off of everybody else's work. So everybody that says, and unfortunately there are some that are going to suffer more than others because of this. You know, anyone that's been working in astronomy, that everything has got to be burned down, and you have to start over. Everything that's astrophysics, that has to be, you know, just dismantled and rebuilt from scratch. But then all the other physical sciences, those have to be retooled. Now, you don't have to throw those out. You can retool those. You know, geology, hydrology, geography, archaeology, everything that we know about carbon dating will probably have to be redone. So I understand, you know, what science is. I get it, you know, that we have to build structure, and you have to give people a foundation for, if they're not into religion, you have to give them a foundation for where we are, what the world is. But the assumptions that they made were based off of, I want to say flaws, but the other part was just a giant deception. And they all bought it, because you could work the models into everything. You know, it's okay, we know that the world is this, you know, which is really an assumption, therefore we're going to base every bit of our science off of that, and we've got to make the math fit. And they did, for the most part. But you remember, well, the Earth was flat, people were still sailing around, you know, going by the stars, and nobody got lost. So if it was, you know, wrong then, you know, what does that say? So, yeah, now, unfortunately, science is going to, you know, because this doesn't look like it's going away by a long shot. Science is going to take some big blows when this finally, you know, comes out. And I feel bad, but at the same time, it's like, look, sometimes you got to start over. And I hope that they understand that this isn't being done out of malicious intent or, you know, to try to get as a giant revolutionary thing. It's like, look, it's coming out. It's like a secret that had flaws, like an affair that you always were suspicious of. And now finally it's starting, like you guys were saying, look, the evidence on the flat side is way, the stack, no play on words there, is way higher than the globe side. So the burden of proof has shifted from, tell me how it's flat to, no, tell me how it's a globe. And to go with what you other guys, yeah, this is a globe skeptic thing. You know, my model, I'm completely open with it. I don't care whose model is actually right, as long as it's not a globe. I mean, not to throw in, you know, Lord Stephen Christ, but even he's not promoting the globe. And, you know, it's like, great, fantastic. So there you have it.
Yeah, that's cool, man. I mean, one of the exciting things about this, you know, subject and its recent popularity in sort of emerging on the internet is that the various different people bringing different ideas to the table, you know, and their investigations, and we're managing to connect lots and lots of dots, and you have a different take on things. Eric DeBay has a different take on things.
Yeah.
It's sort of a collective discovery that we're making right now.
Yeah, I still promote. I'm looking at my very short playlist on YouTube called Flat Earth Related, and I'm looking at the people in there. It's like, you know, there's some people that are rivals or that are considered nemesis material in here, and it's like, look, I still promote Eric Dubé's work, Crow 777's work, my perspective, Jaronism. You know, John Le Bon's in there. Lawrence Wright, he was the guy. He's a guy out of England that he gave me the title for Clue 7, The Long Haul. He was the one, when he saw my clues coming out, he sent me more flight information. And he goes, look, if you want to finish up a clue on flight information, do this. And I was going, oh, what should I call it? He goes, oh, how about The Long Haul? I go, that's perfect. There's so many people every day that are coming out, which is why at the end of every clue I did, I said, look, do your own research, ask your own questions. And people have, which is fantastic. I love that, you know, it probably won't, you know, the smoking gun, if I get the smoking gun when it finally comes out, great. I'll be tickled that it would be me. But, you know, the odds say that it's not going to be me. It's going to be somebody else. And, it's just so fun to watch this thing take this organic path where, you know, people go through their stages. Again, it's like, I'm not going to talk about it. Okay, I'm going to talk about it. All right, it's probably happening. And it's just great watching people go through those stages. Look at that guy. I watched a guy, a small YouTuber guy who made like 7 or 8 videos out of his car, if you remember this guy, who was saying, you know, the flat earth is artificially trending. It's artificially trending. He made like 7 or 8 videos in a row, and then 2 weeks later, he makes a pro flat earth thing called Say Goodbye to the Globe. I was going, it's just incredible. It's just so neat to watch people just flip over, and it's not a sinister thing. It's not a cult thing. It's strictly what it is. It's a real thing.
Well, let me just interject there briefly, guys. We've already gone through half an hour of the show. Time goes quick. My hope tonight, Mark, is that we could get our early questions out there, because I know that Matrix and Dearth have been very excited all week, and now I'm hoping we can spend a little bit of time going through your clues, because that's how you really broke onto the scene. Then we'll start looking at some of the objections to some of the material that you've been putting out there, and then hopefully spend the last 20 or 30 minutes going through the questions from the live chat. We've got more than 40 people watching live, so hello to all of them. With the first 8 clues that you put out, Mark, and this was across February 11 to February 19, so in the space of 8 days, you uploaded 8 clues. Out of the 8, 5 of them were essentially criticisms of the prevailing ball model, and then 3 of them were focusing on your own model. So why don't we spend a bit of time looking at those two sides. Firstly, your criticisms of the ball, then the model that you're proposing. With your criticisms of the spinning ball model, you put up 5. The lack of films about film landings, that was one that you called empty theatre. Then you did the Bird Wall, Admiral Bird talking about Antarctica, what is it really? Flat Earth Clues 3, map makers talking about the azimuth equidistant map, its similarities to the USGS and the United Nations. Flat Earth Clues 5, status quo, why the authorities have an interest in hiding what we're really on. And then Flat Earth Clues 7, the flight path. So there's five arguments that you've put up for dismissing the spinning ball model. Since then, have you come up with any more compelling reasons to dismiss ball model? Are those still your main reasons to bring up to people why they shouldn't believe in the ball?
The big five points that I like to boil it down for people, because you know the people, I get questions all the time. It's like, okay, when I approach family members, when I approach friends, and I go, you know, look, do it very, very carefully, because there's some adverse reactions. If you guys caught, I don't know if it was my last interview or the one before that, where the woman from I can't remember, I think she was from Australia, who was really into frequencies and everything, where she wasn't a co-host, she was a guest, she walked out. She couldn't handle it. And I completely understood with her. I completely sympathized. I was like, look, this is a big deal. Because she had built everything she had, not on just one sphere model, but multiple sphere models and multiple dimensions. And I'm basically saying, no, you can't do that anymore. It doesn't exist. It's not what you think. But to answer your question, there's five points which I throw out there, and I challenge anyone. Again, if you're going to debunk this, it's completely up to you. I'm giving you a fair warning. The Pandora's box, once you go down this road, you're not coming back, which is there's three up above and two below. The big one, the number one, forget about the movies one. I mean, the movies one was really just kind of an appetizer for people, even though I think it's a great clue, which is why I made clue number one. But we'll go straight to the big one, and that is there are no pictures of the Earth from space. None. And what I dare people, I say, okay, fine. You think there are, find me two, because everyone's going to find one. It's the Apollo 17 picture. We can go out, you know, about this to death. But there are no other pictures except for that picture. And you have to ask yourself, with all the supposed satellites that are up there, with the Hubble Space Telescope, with every probe that we've sent out, with all the Apollo stuff, you've got to ask, why aren't there tens of thousands of pictures, and why doesn't NASA own all the rights to them? There's only one picture of the Earth from space. I know when you Google the Earth from space, you see a lot of images. And at first glance, if you're only looking at it for 5 seconds, it's all, oh, no, there's pictures of the Earth from space. No, there aren't. Once you start digging into them, there's nothing but composites and composites and composites. And that roundtable that tried to do this last week, they couldn't touch this, not with a 10-foot pole. The other side was, the question you've got, sorry, I'm reading that in the chat. Yeah, there should be, not only should there be thousands of pictures of the Earth from space, but there should be streaming pictures constantly. Why isn't there a camera on the moon? Forget about the Mars rover, which is a whole other thing I won't even touch. Why isn't there a camera on the moon, an HD camera right now, that just sits and films the Earth? Streaming all the time. Why is the only full motion video that they ever show of the Earth from space, and Matt Boylan tore this apart, that's from Galileo from 1990. And that's the one he picked apart that says, well, yeah, okay, why aren't the clouds morphing? Why is it not a full motion, it's a simulated full motion video of the Earth from space, and the weather isn't morphing? It is absolutely ridiculous to even think, you know, because I actually had a guy tell me the other day, the guy I do programming class with, who said, well, it's NASA's prerogative not to show us those pictures. I'm just going, what are you talking about? Forget about NASA. There's private satellites supposedly all over the place. Nobody's taking a picture of the Earth from space. That's the big one. The second one, which, I'm going to give credit to Max Malone. It wasn't my idea that he came up. And he goes, find me an exterior, and I say exterior because people have emailed me and says, no, there's tons of interior shots of people of the ISS, you know, doing 180s and 360s. I go, no, this is an exterior. Find me an exterior shot from an astronaut, from anybody that even does a 180. And they can't do it. They don't do it. And that's because it is completely staged. If it's not filmed underwater, it's filmed in a soundstage somewhere else. Or, you know, like the Apollo landings. It's like what the Apollo mission, you had cameras there. No one even turns around. Not once. You know, forget about a 360. They didn't even do a 180. That, you know, those two things, big ones, can't be debunked. Third big one, which is the elephant in the room, which I really didn't even talk about in the clues, which is the Van Allen radiation belts. And I mentioned it in the clues, but the big thing about the Van Allen radiation belts is, look, you announced it in 1959. You said it's the deadliest thing ever. It surrounds the Earth. Everyone that tries to go through it is going to die. And you didn't have any shielding for it back then. And then you figure out, oh, hey, the only shielding we have is either one of two things. It's either lead or it's gold. Both are extremely heavy. In fact, gold is twice as heavy as lead. And you can't put lead on top of a rocket, or as that great guy from Ireland said, you can't fly an anchor. You can't shield a capsule with lead. It throws the whole thing off and makes it completely impractical. So the question is, how does Apollo 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, how do all those flights take round trips through the Van Allen, round trips twice through the Van Allen radiation belt, come back, not only does nobody die, nobody gets radiation poisoning, and the capsules aren't contaminated to the point where, they should be behind, lead glass in the Smithsonian, and you did this without shielding. NASA will not answer these questions. That question in particular, that is one they absolutely would, because, and if anyone has any doubts, look up the Orion Project, that stupid little thing that they put out last year, that little video talking about, that they have to deal with the Van Allen, the radiation. They have to deal with that now. It's like, what are you talking about? You did it 50 years ago. Those are the three things up above.
So your three strongest arguments there, Mark, are the no photos of the Earth from space or from the moon, no panorama, and how do they get through the Van Allen belt? Now, these are all criticisms of NASA. The ball earthers, the spinning ball earthers would say to you, okay, even if we accept your arguments, those are arguments to reject NASA, not necessarily to reject the spinning ball. Taking away the NASA fraud or the NASA fakery, what other arguments are the main arguments that you use to argue for the flat Earth model?
Got it. Those would be the two down below. And that is, there's more down below, but the two big ones down below, and I know some people are going to go into the curvature, which I didn't. They're going to go into things about gravity, but it's like, look, people can do experiments all they want with curvature and gravity, and I have no problem with that. Unfortunately, for me, they weren't broad enough strokes to go to the lowest common denominator. There's people out there that, again, if once you say, oh, yeah, by the way, the curvature is 8 inches per mile squared, they're just going to glaze over. There's some people who are going to get it. Some people, some smart people, they're going to get that. But the two big ones that I touched on that even now I've got to, I've got a harp because you can't debunk it. Again, that panel didn't touch it. The big one, the first big one is the airline flights in the Southern Hemisphere, which is the debunking one that I got started on from that guy from Germany, because I looked at it and I was going, no, it can't be. And that is, there's the plane routes in the Southern Hemisphere, everything below the equator. So if you're the big ones, if you're flying from South America to Australia, are really up if you're looking at it from a globe standpoint. And that is, oh, hey, Jaronism just finally showed up. Nice to see you, Jaron. So from a globe standpoint, if you're going from, for people that are hearing this for the first time, if you're going from like Sydney, Australia to Rio or, Buenos Aires, it should be a straight shot across the South Pacific Ocean. And it never is. 95% of the flights in the Southern Hemisphere are connections, and they're bad connections. They're freaking way out of it. There's no way. The perfect example I'll give people is when you're going from Rio to Sydney, it should be a straight shot across the Pacific Ocean. There is no reason to go through San Francisco to get to, to get to one place to the other. And people, oh, we're picking up passengers. No, no, no. That route is way, way off course, and the mileage gets way out of proportion until you apply it to the AE map, which is the azimuthal equidistant map. Then it becomes literally a straight line, and all those connections flatten out. So instead of these big arcing triangles, they become really, really shallow dog legs, and the chances of that happening statistically are very, very remote. But the other part of the second part of that, there's second stage, part B of that one, which is why I did clue 9, which is how do you hide something like that? Because people are saying, no, there's these nonstops. And I cannot tell you how many times they sent me the Auckland, New Zealand to Santiago, Chile. Everybody sent me that, to the point where I had to make clue 9 just to shut them up. which was, it's like, oh, no, you can get a nonstop. And I go, okay, fine. And then when I started looking, and then I saw the flights being dropped off of GPS in the Southern Hemisphere, then I saw it. Then, I mean, I was already hooked by that point, but then I said, oh, that's so clever. Because what you're doing is you're hiding the routes, because that's the second part of this, and that is if you find a nonstop flight, you don't want to show them how that nonstop flight got from point A to point B, so you hide it. You disappear the flights. It doesn't happen in the Northern Hemisphere. GPS, an American military system called global positioning, should not lose flights anywhere. And it does. There's no coverage below the equator over the water. Do you want me to do the Antarctica thing, or you want to introduce Jaronism before I do that?
We'll introduce Jaronism in just a moment. Before we do, though, so your two big arguments for the rejecting the spinning ball on the Earth are the fly paths and the GPS going missing.
That's Antarctica. I'm sorry, there's 3 points, okay, on the ball. First part is the flight pads, second part is the GPS dropping it off, and the third part is Antarctica, which I know some people say, well, that doesn't disprove the ball. It's like, no, it is a big enough mystery that it really does, and that is because it fits in with the flat model, with the AE model, and that is if the AE model, if Antarctica is spread around the outside like a giant wall, like a giant barrier, then you would want to make it secret. You'd want to protect it. And that is exactly what's happening. Since 1959, no corporation ever has in any... they've been forbidden to do anything down there. And that is ironclad. No one can get in there regardless of how much money is involved. And that goes against everything that we are as a civilization economically. Nothing is bigger than money. When it comes to us, we can, you know, if you have enough money, you can do anything, and that does not apply there. The rules do not apply there. And when I saw that, you know, combine that with the fact that the Van Allen radiation belts were announced at the exact same time as the treaty was put in place in Antarctica, that just screams structure. It's like, okay, you're sealing off the upper edge and you're sealing off the outer edge. For me, it was a slam dunk, and there was no way I was backing off of that.
All right, so your three objections: the spinning ball on the ground, the flight pass, the GPS, and Antarctica. We'll come back and pick up on those in a moment. Before we do, though, you are right. We have been joined by Jaronism, so we better say a warm welcome to the Ball Earth Skeptic Roundtable with Jaronism. Thank you for joining us.
Hey, thanks for having me. Hello, everybody.
Hey, Jaron.
Hey, Jaron.
What's going on, Mark? How's everybody doing?
You've got a lot of fans here, Jaronism, so it would be impolite of us not to let you just explain who you are and what you do very briefly, and then we'll come straight back to discussing some of Mark's objections to the spinning ball, because we are the spinning ball skeptics here, and it's only fair if we also look at other people's models and criticisms and what have you. So we'll pick up very shortly. Before we do, though, Mark, I hope you'll forgive us. We'll give Jaronism a couple of minutes to introduce himself.
Oh, have at it.
Okay. Well, if you guys, I'm sure you've seen my videos, but yeah, just somebody who found, you know, was like you guys a year ago and always had a problem with the spinning part of the spinning ball Earth, but, you know, got laughed at in school and told that, you know, that it is the way it is and that's just the way it goes. And so it wasn't until about November or December last year that I kind of came to the conclusion that, God, you know, might it be that the Earth is flat? And I just said to myself, you know, my wife told me to make videos, and I said, I can't. You know, I just said, I can't bring myself to do it. And it was, you know, maybe first week of February of this year that I just happened to search, like, is anybody talking about this? And that's when I saw Mark's clue videos. And just the way he was able to come out and say it gave me the bravado to say, screw it. You know, I mean, I felt strong enough at that point. I can't see at all living on a globe. I think it's preposterous. Gravity, I can't grasp it anymore. I don't know how I ever did. I don't know how they got away with it as long as they did. But once I felt comfortable with it, I just said, you know, I'm just going to go ahead. And I remember being excited when I had 100 views on my very first video. So from there, it was just keep talking about the truth and keep exposing it. And now I've gotten, you know, pretty far as my last video or the video before that. I think I pretty much came up with the debunking of the Coriolis effect. So that felt good. And basically everything that they've ever taught us, now we're able to kind of dig into it with camera equipment. We're able to zoom into the horizon. The boats that always were told went over the horizon, and now we're able to zoom in with a zoom camera or a telephoto lens and actually see that boat is still there. What they call a superior mirage, seeing, you know, distances way over what you should be able to be seeing, what you should be able to see. Those are the things that are just now kind of cementing, you know, what I think is, like you guys said, the biggest deception there is.
Well, so I know that we've got you booked, Jeronism, for a future episode, which we'll talk more about at the end of this episode, but I understand you might just quickly have an update for us about your laser test.
Yeah, sure. I had put out an idea that I had for a laser test. Just, I live here in California right next to Monterey Bay, and there's some unique kind of cutouts in the Monterey Bay that would allow me to shoot a laser across pretty easily across the bay. And so I knew I needed a powerful laser, and I looked them up, and they were, you know, northwards of $200, something I don't have to spend. So I just kind of put it out to the on my channel, just saying, hey, if anybody wants to donate, you know, if I get this $200, I'll go get a laser. Well, that first day, I got an email from a guy named Bob from Colorado, and he said they wanted to buy me, buy me the laser. They liked my videos, they were enjoying them. They liked that I wanted to go out and actually do the experiment. So they bought I actually don't know the price. I think it was probably around $300. It's a 1,000 milliwatt green laser. So I put out a video maybe 3-4 days ago showing when that thing came. It was pretty crazy. You turn that thing on, you got to have goggles when you have it on, and I show myself lighting a match. You could just put a match right in the pathway and lights right up and burns a hole right through, you know, electrical tape. And so it's easily going to go across. Where I'm going to be shooting it from is Lover's Point, which is probably one of the top 10 most gorgeous spots in the United States. So I think that's going to be awesome. And then my problem at that point was I don't have a video camera that would have looked nice. And so I actually got a call from an email from a guy that lives up north near Humboldt, and he said he knew a videographer that lived in Monterey. So he said, I'm going to have him get in contact with you, and maybe he can give you a deal. So the guy called me, and he's done a lot of TV shows, and he said, yeah, I'd be happy to tape it, but he wanted $200. So it was like, all right, well, put that back on my channel, and we had a bunch of people donating $1, and then yesterday Eric Dubay came in and donated the entire $200. So I was able to get this videographer, which is going to be awesome because now we're going to have great video footage of the test. Plus, we'll be able to add looking at some boats go over the horizon. And then also, his office is right up from Lover's Point, and he was telling me on the phone he could see the Santa Cruz beach from where he was. It was that clear. This is on last Friday. And I said, wait, are you kidding me? So I looked that up. It's about 45 miles. So I'm hoping that we have a clear day on Thursday. That's when we're planning on doing the test, Thursday, tomorrow, 7:30 Pacific Standard Time, p.m. And so you guys can check out my channel because I am going to have it live streaming. Now, the live streaming probably won't be the greatest footage because it is going to be taken probably from an iPhone. But the videographer will be there taping the whole thing, and so hopefully by the next day we have the video up. But we're shooting 4 miles from Lover's Point across the ocean to Seaside. In Seaside, there's a interesting spot on the beach there that they call Message Hill. It's a huge sand hill where people drag seaweed up there and write messages up high. But it just worked out perfectly because that gives me a good backdrop to shoot the laser at. So, 7:30, we're going to be there. And you know, I'm not going in with any kind of preconceived notion. I want to see a true test result. So it should be pretty definitive. We kind of went over there the other day and got some preliminary specs on the whole area. Looks like the laser is going to be about 1.5 feet from the water level. So when we throw that across, It either should hit at 1.5 feet on the other side, or it should be 11.5 feet if it's curved. So I'm thinking we're going to get a pretty good result one way or the other. If it's down low, you know, at the 1-2 feet mark, then I think that pretty much is a pretty positive result for a flat. If it's up high at the, you know, 11 or 12 foot mark, that's a pretty good result for the globe. Now, if we get 5 feet, then not really sure how we would address that, but we have it set up so we can do a couple different tests. If it doesn't play out right, we might start the laser pointed at the water and slowly inch it up just a little bit at a time, because also the laser can't go through the water. It'll be refracted in a million different places. So if you start it in the water and tilt it up just a hair at a time, the first place you see it across the shore will tell us whether, you know, if we see it at 2 feet, then it's flat. See it at 12 feet, then it's curved. So I'm excited about it. We checked out the area. It should be beautiful. Weather's supposed to be nice. So we're pretty stoked.
Excellent stuff. So the long and the short of that story then, Jerron, is in about 36 hours on your channel, which I'm sure most of our listeners already subscribed, but if they're not, they can just find you on YouTube, Jerronism. You're going to be doing an experiment with a laser, which should, to some degree, finalize this notion of the curvature. Either your laser will find it or it won't find it, and you'll be live streaming this so people can see it for themselves.
Yep, correct. If they start about 7:30, I'm going to set up the location or show the setup so they can see exactly where the laser is shooting from, and then I'm actually going to leave because I've got to actually drive to the receive location, and then we'll have one of my buddies is going to be at the shooting location. He'll turn on that laser, and we'll be live streaming from the other side at that point, so we'll be able to see where the laser hits.
Hey, I just want to throw in one thing here. If the Earth is flat and there's a single wave anywhere in between you and the target point that's, say, 2 feet, that could skew where you're going to see it by multiple feet. I mean, if it's halfway there and there's a 2-foot wave, that could put you at 10 feet above the horizon. So you have to make sure that there's
How would the laser hit the wave and then the laser can't go through the water?
What I'm saying is, as you're tilting up, if that wave is halfway across and it's 2 feet along, you're not going to see the laser until it's above the wave, and now it's no longer parallel with the flat water.
Right.
That's all I'm saying.
If we just did it one time, the great thing is we're going to keep doing it over and over again. Basically, it's impossible to show the laser hitting the other side at 2 feet if it's curved. It's impossible. There's no way it can happen, because you'd have to shoot through the water for that to happen. So,
listen, I'm 100% on your side there. I'm just saying if there's a 2-foot wave, you're not going to the laser's going to hit at 10 or 20 feet, depending on where that wave is. And you may not be able to see the wave with your eyes, but the laser is going to be, you know, skewed over the wave.
Yeah, and I'm hoping the weather's exactly like it was. We went there Sunday night, and the water was really, really calm. It was awesome. I mean, but it was beautiful. And that's the only thing that worries me about it is the weather. It's supposed to be awesome. That's why we chose Thursday. And if it's not perfect, then we'll probably move it to Friday. I mean, I don't want to do it if it's not perfect weather like we saw, because that's going to really help the result.
Okay.
Well, what we'll do is, Jerron, is we're going to have you on the show at a time in the future, so we'll have to discuss the experiment more. But if it's cool with you, we'll have you stick around for us on the panel. We've got another hour left with Mark Sargent, who is the guest for tonight. And what we'll do is I'll throw a question to Mark challenging his skepticism of the ball, and then we'll go around the panel. Basically, Mark, you're saying that your three reasons for trying to argue for the spinning ball not working, the fly pass, the GPS, and Antarctica, just focusing on the fly pass there, if you or if someone that you trusted could take a direct flight from Sydney to Santiago, Chile, and the flight time fit in with the ball model but not in with the flat Earth model, which suggests that Santiago and Sydney are much further apart, if the flight time fit in based on the plane and the maximum speed of the plane fit in only with the ball and not the flat Earth model, would you have to revisit the flat Earth model, or would you have a way of getting around that?
No, I wouldn't. I wouldn't. There's nothing at this point that's going to make me really refute the flat Earth model, and here's why. Which is, again, why I did Clue 9, which is because I get this question just about every week, and that is, look, you may be able to book the flight. I know some people said, well, they're phantom flights, and you may not be able to do it, and I know that there's one of my videos, or one of the people that I subscribe to, he did a thing called Airline Routes Exposed, where even the nonstop flights, some of those take these weird little stops, these fuel stops. And technically, if you do a fuel stop and nobody gets on or gets off, it still counts as a nonstop. But I don't even pay attention to that. For me, it still comes down to the routes. And that is, fine, you may be able to get from point A to point B. You may be able to get on a plane in Santiago, Chile, and land in Auckland, New Zealand, or Sydney, Australia. But you cannot prove the route. That's my big hang-up. And that is because once you get over the water deliberately, the plane immediately goes into estimated mode or approximated mode. It drops off the screen, and at that point, you have no idea. The plane could be going through a freaking wormhole, and you'd never know it because there's no way to prove it. There's no system in place. Even though it's supposed to be tracking it, it doesn't. So, again, people have said, well, you know, we should, you know, get a fund. I think there's some fund me pages where, and I don't know if you guys are one of the ones that are doing it. It's like, look, that you'll get on a plane, you know, from Santiago to Auckland. It's like, no, don't waste your money because you still, even if you're on that plane, you're not going to be able to prove how it goes there. Yeah, you may be able to take some snapshots out the window, but you're not going to know where you are. You know, an ocean's an ocean.
And, sure, but can't we do some basic mathematics? We can look at the maximum speed of the plane. We can look at the flight times. Then we can just do some basic elementary mathematics. If you've flown from Sydney to Santiago, Chile, just to take one example, and you've done it in 11 hours or whatever the time is, if you can just time the amount of time, yes, you don't know exactly what route you've taken, but if it's a 10 or 11 hours, whatever the case may be, then we can do some basic maths, and it simply wouldn't work on the flat Earth map. I mean, unless you're going to try and say that maybe the plane is traveling well above its maximum speed or something.
No, not at all. What I'm saying is that on a flat Earth map, the route that you would normally take, or over that ocean, the South Pacific Ocean, which you're supposed to be taking, that part of the map becomes stretched and much, much longer. Basically, the map is so wrong that the only way you can make that flight is you have to take a shortcut, a huge shortcut, across oceans that you're not supposed to, bodies of water you're not supposed to go through, and land that you're not supposed to go through. And that accounts for the time that you're talking about.
But you see what I mean? If we're on a ball, then I should be able to go sort of underneath the ball to get from Sydney to Santiago. If we're on a flat Earth map, I have to go right around. And even if it's a straight line, on the flat Earth model, like these southern hemisphere flights, the distance is simply much greater than it would be on a ball. So if we make it in the time that fits the ball, then it doesn't fit the flat Earth map, does it? Unless we're going much faster.
Unless you're going much faster or unless the distances are wrong. The problem is that even the AE map, we don't know, because remember, I treat the AE map, and I think Jarenism does too, as a literal thing, but we don't know the actual perspective as far as the distances between segments on the AE map, because we're treating it as literal, but nobody knows exactly what it looks like, which is, by the way, to digress real quick, on Jarenism's laser test that he's going to do, you know, he's doing it from a purely tabletop flat model where, you know, and that follows the Eric Dubé model as well, whereas I follow the flat and stationary Earth model from 1830 by Orlando Ferguson. So even then, what I'm trying to get is we don't know the exact distances on a flat model because it's never been shown. We don't have a truly accurate map because we don't know the curvature. We don't know if there's any curves at all. So for me, yeah, there is some speculation there, but no, I'm still, there's no way I'm backing off the flat
point
map
table. It is a round table, and Matrix has been quiet. So Matrix, just focusing on Mark's arguments against the spinning ball, his three above are no photos from the Earth from space, no panoramas, and the Van Allen belt. His three reasons on the Earth are the flyer pass, the GPS, and Antarctica. Are any of the reasons that Mark gives to reject spinning ball reasons that you disagree with? Do you have any comments you want to add to any of this?
No, I think they're all good reasons. You know, the lack of photos from space. You know, I mean, what we're getting are supposedly data ribbons from satellites. And, you know, when we analyze those photographs, we can see how they've copied and pasted clouds. So, I mean, it really, you know, there's a massive discrepancy there. And the plane routes, aspect. I've looked into that primarily due to Mark's work, video, and you know, spent a lot of time on the flight tracking sites. And yeah, I mean, they definitely disappear over the ocean. And you know, when I've looked at the Santiago, the Sydney, Australia to Santiago flight, a Qantas flight, you know, on a flight radar 24, it lists the flights that are currently in the air. And that specific Qantas flight was not listed, which was a very curious thing for me. I mean, and another thing about the plane routes, I mean, it's also to do with, you know, planes themselves and aeroplanes, which are curiously named that, and, you know, how they fly with the horizon, and if it were well on a spinning ball, the planes would have to dip with the curvature. Sort of every 30 seconds, I'd have to dip like something like 2,000 to 3,000 feet every 30 seconds. So that's just one aspect of the plane things. The plane aspect, you know, I'm really curious about what Mark thinks about how planes work on this.
That's an excellent point, and I've seen other videos that have put it. In fact, there's a neat little video, and I don't think it's gotten much traction. Maybe I should add it to my playlist, where a guy took a, and I don't remember exactly what the app is on the iPhone, and he flew from New York to London or something like that. And you're right, it wasn't dipping at all. And for people who don't understand what that means is, look, if there is a curvature on the Earth, that means if you're flying completely level, if you have enough power, you would escape Earth. That's what escape velocity is all about. Is, you know, you escape the curvature of the Earth. And if the planes are, you know, if the planes were flying on an Earth, you'd have to compensate that for it by dipping ever so slightly down below. You know, you'd have to point down and point down and point down. And if you're traveling 500 miles an hour.
Half mile per minute. It said it's a half mile per minute that the plane would have to dip.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah, the plane would constantly, and of course it's easy enough to build into autopilot, but it's never ever talked about. You know, and I challenge any pilot that might be listening. It's like, okay, you know, does your autopilot automatically compensate for this? Because no one's ever talked about it. And even if you're not on autopilot, then you'd have to manually do it. And again, nobody's ever talked about this.
Yeah, but the argument of the ball earthers is that gravity has you locked in at a certain altitude, which is just ridiculous. But that's their argument, and you can't deflect them from it.
Yeah, again, that is a silly argument. It's like, yeah, it may lock you in as far as speed goes, again, which is debatable, but not on the orientation of the plane. You know that. That it would automatically start automatically pulling the nose down. Eh.
It's ridiculous.
Don't like it.
Yeah, it relates to the contradiction of, you know, how the atmosphere is supposedly locked down, and yet they also like to claim the Coriolis effect, you know, and how the Earth is spinning. Like some people like to use the sniper rifle argument, how bullets, you know, deflect one way or the other depending on which way you're facing. And, yeah. You know, that supposedly doesn't affect planes, the Coriolis effect.
Yeah, good one. Good one. Yeah, you're right. You can't have it both ways. Yeah. And by the way, I'm a shooter. I'm over here in the States, and I've shot my whole life and read just about every periodical there is on ballistics and shooting. And I can't remember a single one that actually mentioned the Coriolis effect. I'm sorry. I mean, yeah, I didn't shoot that long-range stuff, but I would have, you know, it would have come up in my topics more than once.
Yeah. I mean, Jonism did a good video on it recently regarding the Coriolis effect, and he mentioned, you know, if the atmosphere was fixed, you know, we'd be able to travel to the moon within 4 hours. You know, if the Earth is following the sun at 66,000 miles an hour, you know, with the moon trailing us, we'd be able to pop out of the atmosphere and reach the moon within 4 hours, which I thought was really interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, agreed.
And you know, which didn't happen when we allegedly went to the moon on the Apollo missions. You know, it took 3 days, I think.
Yeah, yeah, the Apollo missions, and I know, and again, I'm going to be like with, you know, Jaronism's going to be on my show on Saturday, And I'm focusing, you know, because everyone says, well, you want to talk about something new. It's like, well, what I'm going to be doing new is, and I know this, it doesn't necessarily apply to the roundtable here, so I won't dwell on it too much, but I am going to spend all my efforts trying to dismantle NASA, because they're the gatekeepers for me. They're the ones that, if there's going to be a fall guy in this, it's going to be them. And they've made too many errors over the years, and I'm going to call them out on every one of them.
I'm not sure who pointed it out, but the most amazing thing about NASA to me is somebody put in a Freedom of Information request about the moon landing. You know, they want the telemetry, the bio data on the, you know, on the astronauts, the blueprints, you know, the whole mission specs, and the reels of data, and NASA says, oh, we lost it.
Oh, yeah, all the telemetry? Yeah.
Yeah, they lost it. Oops, we lost it. The greatest achievement of this round of civilization, and oops, yeah. We lost it.
Yeah, yeah, that stuff would have been so protected. Yeah, it's ridiculous. And again, not to belabor the point, but when it comes to the pictures of the Earth from space, and again, anyone wants to debunk this, I dare you. Come at me with that one, because the only reason why you would hide the real, you know, you would make so few images of the Earth from space is because you're trying to hide what it really looks like. And not to mention, you want to throw in one more coincidence there, that is, look, we went through Apollo 11, 12, 13, 14, all the way through 17, no pictures were taken until the very last mission. And only on 17, then, oh yeah, by the way, we're going to take one shot and that'll be it. You know, we've had the capability since 1957. No one took a full Earth shot until 1972. And then that was the only one they held on to for 40 years. It's beyond ludicrous. So,
I suppose we can agree, we all agree that NASA is fraudulent and they're producing a lot of fake evidence for Ball Earth. I guess because we're all on the same page with that one, I'm trying to get to, are there other arguments that we can use apart from NASA being fake? Because the Ball Earthers will simply say, well, even if you can prove NASA's fake, that doesn't prove we're on a ball. And I guess it's good that we have Geronism here because he's doing experiments to try and prove a lack of curvature. One of the things that you've been criticized for, Mark, on, say, Dubai's forum, not necessarily by Dubai specifically, but just by people, is that you don't focus on these easily provable scientific methods for disproving the ball Earth. Are you planning to make a video in the future talking about the lack of curvature? Is that something that you have no interest in making any videos about whatsoever?
No, for me, and I've stated this at a few other things I've done, which is, look, I don't mind. I love the fact that Geronism, one of the big reasons I don't do it is because other people are going to do it. And it wasn't a make it or break it thing for me. The curvature of the Earth, again, because I don't necessarily subscribe to it, the tabletop model, the curvature isn't as important to me. But I understand it. I mean, it has to be done. It has to be covered. I'm not going to be covering it. I like the broad strokes. I like the big ones that everyone can get their head around. Again, the curvature argument is not for everybody. It might be for everybody in this forum and maybe people that are listening, but there's a lot of people out there that have no idea what you're talking about when you're talking about the curvature. Or gravity for that example. Although I think the gravity test is still very, very good. And not necessarily where you're talking about the planes going from east to west or west to east, but the weight difference, the centrifugal force problem going from the North Pole to the equator, and that is if the equator is spinning at 1,100 miles an hour and the North Pole is spinning at 0 miles an hour or 3 or whatever you want to call it, then a weight, once you measure something up there at the North Pole and you take it down, you know, assuming it's not a human being where the weight fluctuates, a flat weight, and you take it down to the equator, it should be measurably less. You know, maybe even a fraction of an ounce, but it should be less. That, I think, is a more interesting test. Now, will I get into it? Yeah, maybe. But I've talked about it enough in interviews. I'm hoping that somebody else will dig into it. Will I touch on it personally? Probably not. I'm trying to go for the bigger stuff that just about everybody can look at with suspicion and start scratching their head and send people down the roads.
Excellent. Well, I'll tell you what, we're quickly running out of time on tonight's show. So if it's all right with you, Mark, I'll pitch a few questions at you based on some of the criticisms that have come your way. This is natural in the work that we're doing. People will be out there trying to debunk you because you're debunking NASA and what have you. So do you mind if I just ask you a couple of quick questions to do with, you know, your persona in the Flat Earth movement? You know,
sure.
There are some people out there who have criticized you for the pyramids in your avatar on YouTube, for holding balls, like globes, globe Earths, when you're doing interviews on YouTube and on Skype, and yep. for constantly referring to your model, you know, from a game development point of view, rather than focusing on some of these geophysical aspects like the lack of curvature or like the centrifugal thing you just touched on. These sure. are the kind of criticisms that people make. Do you think there's any validity to those criticisms at all, or do you just fob them off?
No, well, I get it. Look, the conspiracy world, and I'm with you there, is a suspicious group, no question. You know, trust no one at face value. I totally understand that. When it came to the pyramids, okay, look, I went to Egypt, had a lot of fun, but you got to understand why I went to Egypt in the first place, and that was I was suspicious of the pyramids themselves. I wanted to see it and look and say, okay, could mankind have built this? You know, especially ancient cultures. And when I looked at it, I, you know, that's what I went there to prove. So we took some great shots when I was there. And no, I didn't put them in because I'm a big fan of pyramids. I just, you know, I was just there. I thought it was a kind of a cool shot. It has nothing to do with anything. As far as holding the globe in some of my early videos, that's because it was really more of a prop. And I think... when the interviewers actually said before he got me, he's going, "Don't use the globe anymore." Not because he didn't like he thought it was a mixed message or anything, but he says, "Look, it's played out." He goes, "You don't need to use that prop anymore. People have already seen it." But that's what I was really going for. It was just a prop that was, I was saying, "Look, this is what I was trying to disprove. This is the lie." You know, if I had a flat model, if I had I didn't want to use some like hand painted cheesy dinner plate with a flat Earth model on it. Otherwise, I would have had that. And I know some people are thinking of doing 3D modeling. You know, using a 3D printer to do a flat Earth model, and that's great if you can pull that off. Fantastic. And what was the third thing? Pyramids, globes, and wasn't there something else?
Well, you constantly refer to your model from a game developer.
Oh, from a gaming standpoint. Yeah. That, look, I used to produce games for a living. I helped design these things. So from a game standpoint, from a design standpoint, that is my perspective. That's how I got these clues wouldn't have been made without that sort of background for me. And that was, I looked at this thing from a functional, I said, look, if I had to design it, if I had to build this, what would I do? And that's what is really what got me going to where once I started digging into it, I was going, man, I don't think I could, you know, and of course, you know, there's arrogance for you. I couldn't improve on this design. It's fantastic. It's brilliant on multiple levels. So yeah, when I refer to it, I'm always looking at it. I mean, I still play games now. After I'm done with you guys, I may actually fire up Warcraft and start playing it a little bit. So I'm not going to back off from that either. From a gaming design standpoint, that's where my head is at. You know, again, I will, but it ties a little bit into the curvature stuff. I like the flat and stationary Earth model, the one with this, you know, it's shaped sort of like a roulette table, because it's more elegant from a design standpoint. You know, it's more elegant. Does that mean that it's right? No. Not necessarily. If Eric Dubé's model or Matt Boylan's model, if it turns out to be tabletop flat, hey, fantastic. I'm not going to lose any sleep over it. I will not cry in a corner. I'll be like, hey, great. It's still not a globe, and that's what it's all about. It's like, look, no matter what model you choose, it is not a globe anymore. So,
and that's where you and I agree. And the thing is, we call this the Ball Earth Skeptic Roundtable. I'm now pretty convinced the spinning ball model they teach us is nonsense, but I'm not convinced of the flat Earth model. Matrix and Dearth seem very convinced of flat Earth, so I might as well throw to Matrix next there. We've got Mark on the panel, and so far I've asked him a couple of tough questions. He's answered them well. And as you and I know, Matrix, when we get other people on some of our other shows, they're not some of the Ball Earthers. They're not so willing to answer the questions like this. I think Mark's answered them well so far, but do you have any tougher questions for Mark about his model or just about the general way he goes about it?
Yeah, okay. Mark, one of my subscribers wanted me to ask you for clarification regarding your view on gravity. I mean, for us, for lots of us who are exploring this subject, we seem to think that, you know, gravity is just really density. I'm wondering what your take on gravity is. I mean, my subscriber mentioned that you possibly think that the Earth is moving up at, you know, 9.8 meters per second to account for gravity. What is your view on gravity?
There's three views on gravity right now when it comes to the non-ball model. And that is, one, you know, you can go with the Eric DeBase side, which is again, easy to understand. It's simple, but it's good, which is it's just density, much like the ball model. And that is, it's really just mass. The second one, which I don't like nearly as much, is the fact that it's moving up, whatever is it, 9 feet per second or 9 meters per second or whatever it is, that it's actually a G force, that it's actually you're moving through whatever space, and that creates gravity. That I don't like nearly as much. If I had to choose between those two, I'd go with density. However, the one I like is mostly, again, from a design standpoint, and that is, look, if it's artificial, if this whole place was made, you know, designed, then gravity is a mechanical process. And that by that I mean, and I've said this in multiple interviews, and that is, from a design standpoint, it is a form of molecular magnetism, for lack of a better word. And that is, imagine a magnet that can grab anything. You know, it, instead of just metal, it can grab organics, clay, wood, sand. It makes no difference. And that is, because really, what's the difference between molecular magnetism and what you call density? Is it really the same thing? I don't know. Gravity, even for mainstream science, is a tricky thing. I like to think it's a mechanical process, because then it can be adjusted like anything else. I don't think there's anything left to chance in this system. I think everything is controlled at one point or another. If you want to call it divine, if you want to call it, you know, advanced technology, it's one thing. But if it turns out to be just flat old density and there's something else behind it, yeah, great. Great, but for me it's mechanical.
Okay. I mean, one of the objections is to the Earth moving up at 9.8 meters per second, is that, you know, planes wouldn't be able to take off, and it would, you know, and if you promote like the dome aspect, it kind of wouldn't be possible. But I just wanted to clear that up, because the Flat Earth Society put forth that argument, and it's one that many consider easily debunked.
You mean the traveling up at speed one?
Yeah.
Again, I don't. If you're gonna do that, you really should stick with the one that works for either the ball or the flat model, which is density. I mean, again, that's the easiest one to get your head around. For me, you know, I try to go, you know, I try to break it down a little bit more, get more granular in, you know, definition. But again, if people want to go with density, that's fine.
Okay. I mean, if you're using the roulette table math, I mean, how does water curve?
Oh, in that case,
water always seems to be leveling out.
Yeah, in that case, you would have to use mine, which is molecular, you know, some sort of molecular magnetism, absolutely, because then you'd have to control the water on all sides. And again, the tabletop flat model works better with water. I'll be the first one to admit that. It's not the one I would use, just because, you know, I like the sunrise and sunsets, how they work on the roulette table a little better. You know, I know people, because water flows downhill naturally, and it, you know, and it flows, you want to go with that because, well, we see it in nature. It's like, yeah, but maybe you could artificially control that. I believe it can. So, but again, if I am proven wrong in the end, it still does not change the fact that the ball model, the globe model, is seems to be an endangered species at this point.
Okay.
Good stuff, man. Thanks. All right, then. Well, Dearth, any objections or questions for Mark about his model?
I've got a question on your view on the ability to see satellites and the International Space Station. I, you know, have seen the what they call the space station fly by, you know, with a space station flight tracker, but all I'm seeing is a light in the sky.
Yep.
I'm curious on your opinion on that, but one thing you mentioned two or three times in this chat, that you related the Earth to a roulette table, and I just want to point out that the shills are going to come after you for that, because if you add up all of the numbers on a roulette table, it adds up to 666. So I'm sure you are pushing the Satanistic
agenda. Holy
smokes,
is that true?
Yeah, it's true. So maybe you want to stop using that as a...
all right, you're right. I will not say roulette table. I'll say hubcap at this point. Okay. Totally smoked. I had no idea. Why didn't anybody tell me that?
I literally just found that out the other day. PK put out a 30-second video pointing out that he added up the numbers for some reason, and it came out to 666. I never checked it. I just trusted his math, but...
Well, there's not that many, so after we're done, I'm going to check it myself. And if it is true, then you're right. I will never mention roulette table again. But to your question about the ISS and satellites, as you guys have probably known and heard me say, you know, up here in Colorado, I have watched, you know, using night vision binoculars, which I highly recommend if anybody has the means, go get them, because the sky is crawling with stuff that... Yeah, there's a lot of stuff flying up there. Yeah, have I seen video of the ISS? Yeah, of course I have. But my suspicion now is the same that it was months ago, and that is, the video, if anyone wants to look it up, the ISS hoax video, which I think is damning when it comes to that, and that is, look, yeah, do we have the technology to put people on a station? Yes, we do. But if we have that technology, then why are you faking the interior footage of people on the ISS station? There's no reason to do it if you can do it for real. And for me, as soon as I saw that, it's like, okay, how can I trust anything because of Apollo anyway? But I'll back it up because some people want to hold on to the ISS. It's like, look, if you're faking it up there, the only reason you're faking it is because there's something stopping you. There's something wrong up there that you don't want to risk putting people up there. There's something going on. So as soon as the ISS gets thrown out the window for me, it's like, how can I trust anything above spy planes? Yeah, do I see stuff flying up there? Yeah. Do I know that they're satellites? No, I do not know that they're satellites. There are very, very few images of the actual satellites, even though there's supposedly thousands and thousands up there. I mean, tens of thousands, depending on who you ask. So I don't trust anything above spy planes right now. The ISS, I firmly believe in my heart that, like, look, yeah, there may be something flying above you. Is it a hologram? Is it real? Is it a physical thing? Yeah, maybe it's a physical thing, but there's no people on it. You got to ask yourself why. And there's just too many dots that I keep following that say, all right, they keep hiding the fact that there's an altitude problem. There's something going on up there that's stopping them from doing work up there. And again, it goes into my, you know, maybe it's not a physical dome. Maybe it is a force field. Maybe it is a radiation belt. But there's something, I believe that there is a barrier up there, if you want to call it the firmament, you can, that there's stopping us from doing any work above a certain altitude.
Mark, I want to throw out one thing about if there is something orbiting, you know, whatever an orbit is a flat orbit or you know, globe, ball, Earth orbit, we're supposedly seeing the sunlight reflecting off of them. So I'm not sure what's up there, but we are seeing something. But I've laid out in the and watched the stars down in the Caribbean and seen satellites, seen the space station close to midnight. And midnight would put the sun on the opposite side of the Earth. What we're seeing are satellites in the space station, which are very, very close to the Earth. So they would be on a ball Earth model eclipsed by the shadow of the Earth almost the entire time. But I see them go from horizon to horizon. If there is something up there reflecting sunlight, that works on a flat Earth model, but it doesn't work on a ball Earth model.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's interesting. Yeah.
Good point. Yeah. Jaren, did you have something?
I was just going to say, because I do hear a lot of the Mark Sargent's a shill talk. So, but what I think is funny about it is that I wouldn't have done my videos if it wasn't for the clues. And I'm actually going after some of the, you know, the curvature facts, the gravity facts, the Coriolis effect and that stuff. So if it was a government ops, it's just more evidence that CIA and government sucks, because look what they did. Because now I'm doing videos, so... Thanks, Mark, if you're a shill. I appreciate it.
Oh, yeah. Mark,
as we said before the chat, if you are a shill, you're doing a horrible job.
I'm doing a horrible job if I'm a shill. Please, anyone that wants to call me a shill, tell me how I am hurting this movement, because it has gotten so much so I mean, look at the thousands of videos that have come out, and you know, I am not professing myself to be any sort of leader in this. Look, I just put out some videos, thought I'd make a couple points. If let's put it this way, if I am a shill, then there is no reason for me to go after. Look, shills are pretty much under orders. You do not go after the U.S. government. You do not go after a very high-profile military wing known as NASA, which I firmly believe that you know. And I'll say this in the show on Saturday that I'm doing, and that is, look, I'll come out and say it. Look, NASA needs to be shut down. Anybody that's doing subcontractor work for these guys needs to get out of there. If you own stock in a public company that is tied to NASA, get out, because these guys have a shelf life at this point. They're not going to hold up. The internet hive mind, social media, and if they end up being the fall guy for this, great. I stated that in one of my videos. Look, they are the first people that are going to have to go down in a twisted pile of molten metal. So yeah, if I'm a shill, I should not be able to say that, and I am saying that. So please stop calling me a shill, and I have to blame Eric. I'm not going to pick on you too much, Eric, but you're the one that started this.
Well, you know, I'll have to interject there. There are other reasons that people might suggest. I mean, people will say, well, sometimes a shill has to give good information, and they have to accidentally wake people up, but at the same time, they'll muddy the waters. For instance, if they give models that don't work, or if they give models that don't stand up to scrutiny, or if they throw in little things into their model that will turn people off instantly, such as if they start talking about the creators of the dome, or if they start talking about the moon, you know, their models for the moon not making sense. I mean, the idea is if you're some of the objections, Mark, is if your model doesn't stand up to proper scrutiny, then even though you're putting in some good info, maybe you're muddying the waters. What do you say to that?
Well, and I completely understand. And I've also got I should probably address it. It's like, look, I understand I've done a lot of interviews recently. And you also have to understand I solicited none of these people. Every one of them called me, and they sort of fed off each other. You know, it was like, oh, well, if he's doing it. It was kind of like everyone was daring each other. Oh, I'm going to do an interview about Flat Earth. But once the first few started doing it, it became fair game. But as far as what you're talking about with the model standpoint, I tried to remain as neutral and open-minded as possible. Again, not what a shill does. The hubcap model, notice I didn't say roulette table. The hubcap model is not that much different from the tabletop flat model. And, you know, not different enough to where if there's something wrong with that model, all of a sudden you have to throw Flat Earth out the window. There's no way you're going to be able to do that. The moon, where I say, look, there's a 3D, you know, a 3D structure, you know, with the moon, something being overlaid off the top of it. If the difference between that and a 2D model, which Eric goes down, again, not much of a difference, which is why he and we still never had really a debate, because we're not debating over that many little, you know, that many points that make any difference. What was the other thing? Oh, the religion thing. Again, which is why I stated, look, I covered the big five religions. I was neutral in all of them, you know, Buddhism, Hinduism, Judaism, Islam, and Christianity. I'm not playing favorites, and I was raised born-again Christian. I know a lot of there's a lot of religious ties to this. But at the same time, I have to play it neutral, because this message isn't about, for me, it's not about religion. It's about everyone. It's about just getting out there. It's like, look, it's about the truth, and the truth isn't biased to one faith. And again, even though I was raised a certain way, the message is for everyone. It's not just for one group. So
this idea that if you are a shill, you're doing a poor job. I said already that it was your clues that got me thinking about this. It's the same for Dave. Obviously, Jeronism has just said the same thing. So you've had a large influence on a lot of people, and because you end all of your clues with "do your own research," what's your little key phrase at the end there? Do your own research.
Treat others better than you treat yourself.
And do your own research. And that's the thing. I know a lot of people.
And ask questions.
And ask questions. That's one. Do your own research and ask questions. And I think a lot of people, they've seen your clues. They've then gone on to do their own research. They've discovered the Bedford level experiments. They've discovered people like Jeronism doing their own experiments. So even though your clues don't cover this stuff, you have got lots of people all around the world going and doing their own research. So I think if you are a shill, you're doing a terrible job, unless this is a long-term game. Now, let me throw something to you, Mark, and then we'll go around the panel to get their opinions. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Dylan Avery, but he's the character who released the first Loose Change back in December 2005. Loose Change.
Right, being right, filmed. Right. I remember that. Yeah.
So let me pitch something to you guys, and we'll go to you first, Mark. Basically, Dylan Avery released Loose Change, and he was the one that released the film, you know, talking about missiles under the plane and really muddying the waters from the start. But where he really seemed to side with people was that now he says that he doesn't think Bush could plan a bowl of cereal, and he says that the conspiracy world is a dark, dangerous world, the world of conspiracy. It is easy to get sucked in and really hard to get back out. And so there's this notion out there now that Avery was right from the start meant to muddy the waters as best as he could, and then once he'd done that job, to then come out and say, no, the 9/11 conspiracy stuff, it's all crazy. Look at me. I was a leading conspiracy theorist. Now I've changed my mind. So anyone who's still in there, they've just been sucked in like I was. You can see where I'm going with this. So there's this idea that whether it's Mark Sargent or Eric Dubai or John LeBon or Jaronism or any of the people, and I don't mean to put myself in your category, but you get what I'm going with here. It could be any of this. There's this idea that someone will get a following and then all of a sudden flip and say, oh, no, this was all just an academic experiment to see how gullible conspiracy theorists are. There's this idea that eventually someone's going to flip and make us all look silly as part of a long-term game. So I want to know, Mark, if you think that this is possible, that this program's already started, and if you can see this happening, and then we'll go through the roundtable and get people's opinions.
Okay, it is possible, and that question has been posed to me before, although not in quite that way. I like the way you put it. And that is, look, could it happen? Yes. Would it happen with me? Will I do? I can tell you right now, I will not do a Joe Rogan. And for those of you who don't know who Joe Rogan is, he was a big, you know, a guy that really, you know, entertainer that went against the Apollo programs and, you know, especially, you know, just really dug into it. And because of his conviction, he was really winning a lot of these arguments. Even, you know, even though the arguments seemed fairly even, his conviction was moving it forward. And then all of a sudden, he flipped. And he turned the other way, and all next thing you know, he's got his own show. Granted, it was only for a year on the Sci-Fi Network. He had Neil deGrasse Tyson on his radio show, and he retracted. And the condition was, you could tell that somebody, you know, paid him off or you know, threatened him or whatever, and said, "Oh yeah, by the way, in the first episode of your new television show, you're going to have to recant everything you said about the moon program." And he did. Will I flip? No, I won't. I can tell you this with the utmost conviction. I will die before I go back on this because this is important. This isn't like the Apollo program where you're just trying to discredit one thing. This, for me, and I wasn't kidding when I got to, you know, Clue 10 and 11, which is, look, for me, this changes the world for the better. This is the only conspiracy I know of that can actually help our civilization. It can help turn us around. From we become accountable and we become better as a civilization. So no, will I flip? No, not a chance. If I end up dead, you'll know why. That is because they offered me something. You know, the joke is, the running joke is, like, okay, they put a briefcase of money on one side of the table and they put a gun on the other and they say, you choose. You know, they give you the carrot and the stick at the same time. And you know, you have to make the choice. No, I will not do it. If there's anything else I can do other than that statement right there to prove that I am not a shill, please email me at msargent23@comcast.net and tell me what I can do to prove to you I am not one. Because that's the only thing I can say. Look, I will die before I recant on this thing unless I'm proven dead wrong, which I can't see that happening.
That's a terrific answer. Look, if you're joining us late, we've got about 70 people watching live right now in our third episode, so thanks to everyone for coming out. We're going to go around the roundtable now. We've got Matrix, David Weiss from Deep Inside the Rabbit Hole. Jaronism has stepped in as a late-minute special guest as well, so it's an all-star cast. Matrix, what do you think about this idea that eventually one of you leading lights of the Flat Earth community are going to try and throw us under the bus and discredit us? And if it's possible, is there a way that we can head that off early?
Yeah, well, I think it's possible that something like that will happen. It would be part of a strategy employed against the Flat Earth subject. I mean, I definitely see, this gaining so much heat and attention at the moment. The powers that be would want to stop it one way or another. I mean, you've got, you know, various politicians and like Obama, you know, mentioning Flat Earth and trying to keep it ridiculed, you know, a subject of ridicule. And then there's the whole, you know, the Flat Earth subject is a CIA psyop to discredit the truth movement, which I think is an illogical one, and I sort of agree with Mark, and Others that are, you know, why would they want us to expose NASA and science fraud? One of the things some people say about you, Mark, is rather than looking at the proofs of the Earth being flat, like you know, the lack of measurable curvature and how water always levels out, and they say like you like to speculate a lot. I was wondering, you know, what are your thoughts on something like the horizon always rising up to eye level when viewed from high altitude balloons, and that if we were on the ball, the horizon would drop further below us the higher you go.
So you're wondering if what my take on it as far as just that perspective, when that the computer simulations, what you're talking about, when you rise up and it still stays the same?
Yeah.
I agree with it. You know, the model that I follow is slightly different, but it's not enough. I agree with that. That's on a globe, when you rise up, it should drop away from you. If it was a true globe or a true ball, no question. I think it's a sound theory. Do I, you know, for me, it's slightly different, but not enough to change the, you know, not enough to discount either one for me. So yeah, I've seen the computer model you're talking about, and I dig it. It's a cool model. It's still tough, which is, again, for those people who don't know, my perspective, I'm not talking my perspective, I'm talking the YouTube channel, my perspective, Rory Cooper out of South Africa, he makes those great 3D, you know, perspective models, panning around and tilting up and down and raising up. But it takes a certain mindset to literally get your head around it, which is why I really don't deal with that one that much.
Okay, fair enough.
Over the journey, we're going to get better at this throwing to each other across the round table. It's only the third episode, Mark. We're so fortunate to have you on board early in the season. Dearth, do you want to just expand any thoughts that you might have on this general notion that eventually somebody is going to come out and say, oh, it was all just an act and I sucked everybody in? Because me personally, I can see, the way that I see it is, if there was to be an outside influence here, it wouldn't be to start this whole thing off from the start. It would be to come in and try and push it one way or another, and then somehow strategically throw us all under the bus. Can you see that happening? Have you thought about it? And if it is possible, how would you go about trying to mitigate the fallout should and when it happen?
You know, I have thought about it. I've been doing a lot of work on, you know, exposing the big three, I call it 9/11, Sandy Hook, and Boston, along with a bunch of other false flags. I've, you know, pushed through the resistance over the last couple years, and have woken a lot of people up to this. And then when I discovered this, you know, ball earth skepticism, I was like, I said, I couldn't even talk about it because people will just discredit everything else I do. And to that I say, you know, if you believe in something that somebody says, and then they say something that you don't believe in, that does not discredit them unless you are just trusting them and not investigating for yourself. And I thought about the implications of the Earth not being a ball, and I realized that it's too big of an issue not to talk about. And as I've said in previous shows, this can and will be used against us to discredit everything we've ever done before, and it's happened. Just the other day, I put a comment on a YouTuber's channel that they missed the ball on something, which they totally did, no pun intended, different subject. And a bunch of people supported me, but this one troll came on and just like, look at this guy, you know, check out his channel. He believes the earth is flat. He believes, you know, and just started using this against me. So yeah, it's for people that don't investigate, it will be used against you effectively. But for anybody that does what I did, starts looking into it, and objectively looks at the evidence, the more you look, the deeper down the rabbit hole you go. So,
if I may interject, yeah, you're absolutely right. That will happen to a certain degree, because again, it's that knee-jerk response where, and I get the argument. It's like, well, no, you're going to make all conspiracy people look crazy. And I'm going, well, you know, you didn't, that aura is already there. But at the same time, the exposure, because beforehand this was a topic, like you said, it was too big to talk about. That's why it was. That's why it's considered ridiculous. There are conspiracies. This is the conspiracy that's so big that your mind literally physically rejects it. I remember literally when I first was going to click on my first link on this, I got flushed. I literally got embarrassed, physically embarrassed, because I was going to click on this. And I was shocked at myself. I was going, why am I getting physically upset about this, trying to click on this? And it's because it's too big, you know, it's for the average person. And so, yeah, you know, there'll be people, it's like, oh, you know, you think the earth was flat, but at the same time, the exposure is invaluable, because, you know, the more people that click on this, for every, you know, it takes some while, and everybody's got their own absorption process, but the more people that click on this, the more people are going to get, you know, taken down the rabbit hole. And it's going to grow. I guarantee it.
Good stuff. Well, Jeronism, do you have any thoughts to add to this general topic about, you know, people's motivations here and what might happen in the future?
I'm not worried about it personally, just because I think that there's too much evidence that there's no way that we're on a globe. I mean, you could look at the speed that we're spinning and nobody's ever felt a thing. And then when you add the 66,000 miles per hour, and you add the speed that we're going around the sun, and add the speed that the sun's going around the galaxy, and then you look at GPS, and you look at the fake images, and you look at the horizon going to the eye level, and you know, there's been a couple lunar eclipses before where both the sun and the moon were above the horizon, and those are documented. The fact that architects, engineers, surveyors don't take into account the curvature when they build railroads or build tunnels. I've had two people email me that are both in the satellite industry that come right out and say that they've had to aim a satellite at another satellite, ground-based, and they have to get it exactly right. They have to be lined up perfectly, but they say those satellites are 50 to 60 miles apart. It's completely, that's a 2,000 foot curvature. So, I mean, that right there is all I need to hear to know it's not curved. So at this point, I mean, I'm not even willing to say it's a flat earth, even though my logo may be a flat earth. I just know it's not a globe. And if once you know that, then you start saying, well, then we probably aren't in space. And if we're not in space, then I don't believe anymore that stars are trillions of miles away, or that planets can be landed on, and that the moon can be landed on. So once you start getting into that, I'm not worried about it at all. It took a little time for me to get used to getting, you know, berated constantly. I've even had one guy that is a space nut that has made four videos, I think, about me. You know, my name's right there in the title, Debunking Jaronism. And he pronounces my name wrong on purpose and calls me a bunch of names and says I give people cancer. And that was hard. That was hard to get used to. It's not that funny.
I'm sorry.
He calls me Jaronism. Really pisses me off. But just getting over the fact, and I just kind of settle it with, they can believe that, and I understand why they do, because I did. And I've said this story before, but my wife said, it's probably a year and a half ago, that we're sitting across from each other, and she said, do you think that the Earth could be flat? And I laughed in her face. And I still feel bad to this day for it, because I just said, what are you talking about? Have you ever flown in a plane? How would you get from one side of the earth to the other? And just dismissed what she said as we were taught to. And when I started looking into it, you know, November last year, it just changed everything, because you just have to give yourself that initial opening to contemplate it. And that's what I know these guys can't do. I mean, this guy that's making these videos about me, he's going to Cape Canaveral to watch all the launches all the time. I mean, that's a breakdown of his entire life. And yeah. So I just have to learn that's not, I equate it to trying to convert a Christian to Islam with a couple videos. It's not going to happen. You know, I just need to learn it's not going to happen. That's not who's going to realize that this is a, you know, this is a hoax or a big conspiracy. So I just need to learn to kind of leave those alone. But I don't think, I'm not worried about anybody. There's nothing anybody could come out and say to me. There's nothing. NASA can't produce a picture tomorrow of the globe Earth, because I'll say, well, why? Water, how does water lay flat? Show me the curve. Measure the curve. They can't measure it. If they could, they would. They can't. So I'm not worried about it.
Good stuff. Well, from my perspective, like I said, I'm not convinced of the flat Earth model yet, but I'm doing my research. I'm reading Dubai's book. At the moment, though, I have said openly, I just can't believe the spinning ball model now. It seems ridiculous to me. There's too many objections to it. So from my perspective, if they can come out with some strong evidence of the ball model, I'll be happy to see it, and I'll be happy to say, well, I didn't believe it, now I do. I don't see the problem with that. I think if you can be open enough to say that you're happy to change your mind based on evidence that you'll do so, you've got nothing to fear, and I've got nothing to fear. I've said clearly what my objections to the spinning ball model are. If someone can provide the evidence, I'll change my mind. But so far, each and every time someone tries to debunk me, or when I watch videos trying to debunk you guys, I become more convinced that the spinning ball model is terrible, because the arguments that are giving for spinning ball, like we saw in last week's We'll Do Alive, they're terrible. If they're the best arguments you've got for spinning ball, you need to give it away right now. But in the live chat, guys, we've got 70 people watching, and there's one topic they keep bringing back up. So I'd love to get your opinions on this one, even if it's relatively briefly. We can spend more time on it in future episodes. But the live chat keep asking, how do you explain the moon? And in particular, how do you explain eclipses? So we'll start off with you there, Mark, and then we'll go around the round table. On your model, from your perspective, how do you explain the moon? And in particular, how do you explain eclipses?
In fact, it doesn't even have to be my model in this case. But when it comes to the moon, look, the moon is not what you think it is. And I'll be as brief as I can. I point people to it all the time, and that is the Crow 777 videos, CROW 777 videos. When you watch those, and that's really what turned me on, you know, to the whole moon thing and what was screwed up there, and that is when you watch his really, really high-res videos of the moon and you see the refresh issue, if you see the resolution issue that's happening in the moon, you've got to wonder what you're looking at. The moon, in my model, and this is a little different from Eric's model, do I think it's a three-dimensional structure? Yes, I do. Do I think it's being overlaid by something on top of it, some sort of image? Yes, I do. I challenge anybody to watch the Crow videos and say differently. Because, again, from a design standpoint, when I looked at it, I'm just shaking my head, you know, like I'm in a cartoon, going, why is the moon doing that? They cannot be doing that unless it is not what you think it is. And when it comes to like lunar eclipses, if that's the case, then yeah, lunar eclipses absolutely have to be artificial. You know, we're talking about blood moons, because there is no Earth between the sun and the moon. But once you watch that video, you're saying, oh, that's easy. You know, it's just a display issue. If you want to have a happy face show up on the moon, you could do it. It's very, very easy to do. You could spell your name out in craters on the moon if the way it's being projected. So no, the moon is not 237,000 miles away. It is much closer. It is much smaller. Is it three dimensional? I believe it is. Could it be two dimensional? It's very possible. So there you go.
Well, we'll get to Matrix opinion in just a moment, but really quickly there, Mark, I first met you on the Fakeologist roundtable, the Fakeologist Flat Earth Clues roundtable on March 22, yep, about 3 months ago. Uh-huh. And I mentioned to you then that Eric Dubai claims that it's been documented in the past that the wandering planet, the wandering stars, what we now call planets, have, yep, been seen through the moon. And you indicated that you weren't familiar with this theory. It was the first time that you'd heard it. In the 3 months since, have you spent any time looking into Dubai's claims about the wandering stars being seen through the moon?
I have, and again, not knocking Eric's stuff. Still like Eric's stuff. But for me, it still comes down to whoever's got the best video wins. And so if there's a video out there that shows, you know, better stuff, that shows that the moon may be transparent, that the moon, you know, may have, you know, that there are issues that are going in front and behind it, I will still, you know, I am still open to that, no question. I am holding on to the 3D model, which has an overlay on it. But again, for me, it's a minor point. That point is not going to change too many people's minds one way or the other. It's not going to change the flat model at all, as far as, you know, whether it's a globe or not. All it's going to do is like, oh well, you know, the moon may be this or the moon may be that, but I'm still not discounting it.
Very good point. Well, I'll tell you what, for those who are interested, you can check that out on my channel, John the Blind. It was a 3-hour roundtable. We looked through the first 3 flat earth clues, and this was only a few days after I first saw your work, Mark. So I was so thrilled just to be talking to you, and it was a terrific 3-hour roundtable. I've put together a pictorial representation of the whole because it was an audio roundtable, but I put together photos to sort of make it easy to watch. So if people are interested, they can check that out on my channel. That's a shameless plug. I reserve the right to do that once every 2 hours. Forgive me. Matrix, we'll throw to you there, mate. Any thoughts on the moon, and in particular, what Marcus had to say?
Yeah, well, I mean, I agree that the moon is a mystery object. I mean, we really don't know what it is at this point, how it behaves, you know, the various different properties of it, and it's just definitely something I'm looking more and more into these days. I'm wondering what Mark thinks about the sun, planets, and the stars.
The sun is really, again, it comes model, there's, I break it down into two sections. One is planets and stars, for just a giant part of an interior part of a planetarium. Are they solid objects? Maybe, but I think beautifully rendered. Do I think they're, you know, actually stars? I doubt it. You know, because you don't have to have them be real. They're definitely not millions of light years away. That's the interior part. As far as the two objects, again, from a design standpoint, it makes more sense to me that the moon and the sun are both three-dimensional objects. The moon being, you know, a giant nightlight, and the sun being, you know, a giant spotlight. Some people have said, well, you know, that it's an omnidirectional light. Some people said that it's a semi-directional light, because if it's a tabletop flat model, then you got to do some stuff with the sun's light source, because, you know, you can't have it shining in all places at the same time. I know people have done different little simulations on that, but for me, it's still a three-dimensional object, because you'd want it to be, as opposed to like the Truman Show, where it's just, you know, part of the interior part of the planetarium, which again, also possible, but I don't like it as much. As having it three-dimensional, because you have a lot more options that way. So that could sort of answer it.
Yeah.
Well, we'll move on to Dearth. Any thoughts on the moon and Mark's opinions on what the moon is?
I put out a video on my channel, DITRH, called The Electric Universe Meets, I forget what it's called actually, but it's called Quantum Locking. And it's about how things can be placed in space electrically, through electricity and magnetism. And I recommend that people watch it. It kind of explains the moon and the sun to me, and possibly the planets and satellites. And that's all I got to say about that. I also just wanted to plug for everyone there, we'll be posting links to the show, upcoming guests, and the latest videos that we find on, for those of you that use the evil Facebook, and the name of the page is Ball Earth Skeptic. Check it out. You know, send the comments in. If you find any videos, send them over. I'll post them. And it's just a way to compile the latest videos that people are making. I've got a little bit of everybody's work up there. Ball Earth Skeptic.
For those who are wondering if Dearth is getting in his final thoughts early, no, he's just very clever. He's going to have two sets of final thoughts. Thank you, Dearth. We'll get back to that later. Turinism, any thoughts on the moon, and in particular, Mark's opinion on the moon?
I've talked to Mark before. We have different opinions on that, but I don't know. To me, it doesn't really matter, because it works, does its job, and I mean, there's little things that we can say about it, that it's got different light than the sun, so I don't think it's a reflective device. It's got different properties. There's no heat involved with it. You can hold a magnifying glass to that light. It doesn't change the temperature of a thermometer at all. I mean, to me, I think it's a disc, because I've taken some close-up pictures of it, and I know the properties of a sphere. And it doesn't show a hot spot, doesn't have shadows at the top and bottom. So I'm looking forward to the next full moon. I think it's the end of this month. Because I do enjoy taking pictures of that and kind of checking it out. But like I said, it works. So to me, it's not a matter of, even if we found out exactly how it works, what difference does that make? It still works. But I like Dearth's Electric Universe, because I've always felt that there is some sort of electric magnetism going on, with Tesla being able to somehow draw from the atmosphere, or from the ether. He kind of knew that there was some connection there. So I think that there might be, I'm anxious to see his video, because I kind of think the same thing, that if something's going to move those two lights around, it would have to be something electric, something magnetic. And, yeah, I'm anxious to see that video. He says it also could include what happens with stars, and if it includes satellites too, I'll be probably going over there as soon as we close this down.
Well, we have to wrap this up very quickly, but before we do, Geronism, just quickly, in the live chat, a couple of people are anxious to know what you think can account for eclipses. Do you have any idea at all, or is it still a great mystery to you?
No, it's still a mystery. I just know it can't be the Earth. There's over 50 chronicled and reported eclipses that both the Sun and the Moon were above the horizon, so they can't say that that's some sort of light bending because it's bending the wrong way. Shadows can't pop up. So to me, it's something that's I want to look into, investigate, but I don't have an answer for that yet.
Terrific stuff. Well, it is time to wrap the show. We try and keep these to 2 hours just to make them more listenable for, pardon me, for the listeners. So we'll get to our final thoughts. We'll start with their metrics. With the five of us on the panel, none of us have got to speak as much as we do on our impromptu chats, but I've enjoyed the show. What are your thoughts on episode 3 of the Ball Earth Skeptic Roundtable?
Yeah, I think it's been a good show. I think Mark has answered a lot of questions. And I'm wondering whether, hoping that he's going to make some more Flat Earth Clue videos addressing various different aspects of the subject. I've just enjoyed it. I'm glad to be joined by Geronism as well. That's it. Thanks.
Good stuff. Well, I'm tempted to skip you, Dearth, but I love you too much, so we'll give you a chance for your final thoughts for episode 3.
I just want to reiterate again that if Mark is a shill, I think he's failing, and it just doesn't make any sense to me. I don't see it. Maybe you are. Maybe I am. Who knows? But upcoming guests, John, you want to announce the upcoming guests?
Oh, you seem to be the one that's organizing them all, so you might as well have the honor.
So next week we have Roy Cooper. Following week, July 8th, we have Eric Dubay. The 15th, we have Geronism is going to come on. And then July 22nd, Stinky Cash. All of those are listed on the Facebook page, Ball Earth Skeptic. Check out their work. Compile some questions. Send them in. We'll ask as many hard questions as we can. And the idea is not to prove the Earth is flat, or a ball, just to figure out what it is.
Good stuff. Well, Geronism, you joined us late as like a second special guest for the episode, but I'm very thankful that you did so, especially because you've got this test coming up in about 36 hours. Any final thoughts for episode 3?
No, thanks for having me. Look forward to the 15th to be back with you guys, and then just to everybody, if you want to tune in tomorrow, 7:30, let's see what happens.
Yeah, and let's point out once again that this is somebody who's actually doing an empirical experiment. He'll be doing it live and apparently for the first time. So if it doesn't go the way that we plan it to go, we'll all have egg on our faces. So Geronism, a lot of people have a lot riding on this, and people can tune in live in about 36 hours' time. And Mark, our main special guest for the episode, a huge thanks for coming along, and also thanks for answering some of the tougher questions. Like I said earlier, Matrix and I have done a couple of shows, not quite as, I don't want to say formal, but not quite as structured as this episode, but we have had people come on and ask them to explain their ball earth theories, and they're not very good at it, and they tend to get very emotional. So for you to answer the questions that you have in the manner that you have, I appreciate it. I think you've done well. Any final thoughts for your first visit? And before I do throw to you, can you tell us if you'll be back on the Ball Earth Skeptic Roundtable in the future? Can we expect you again?
Oh, I'd love to be back. I had a lot of fun. But as far as just my final thoughts, is like, look, regardless of what the model is, what exactly it looks at, like, and that's what this thing is really all about. Everyone's got to understand, you know, the skeptics that are out there, that something's being hidden from us. The world is not what you think it is. It does not look what you think it is. Now, it may be ridiculous to use the words flat Earth. I completely agree, which is, you know, why I went with the enclosed world option. But at the same time, it's becoming more and more apparent to everybody out there that it is not a globe, it is not a sphere, it is not a ball. That's what we're trying to get at, and you know, with any luck, that's where, you know, we will reach that goal. So,
excellent stuff. And of course, for the very small percentage of our listeners who aren't familiar, they can find you on YouTube, Mark K. Sargent, and of course, enclosedworld.com. Is that correct?
Yes, it is. And, you know, my thing I always try to end with is, like, look, I believe in, above all, you know, treat others better than you treat yourself. You'll get a lot further in life.
Excellent. Well, I've said this to you before, but I'll say it again. Thank you for the work that you've done. Even if you do turn out to be a shill who's going to try and throw us under the bus, your show's got me interested in this in the first place. And since then, I found it a wonderful experience to research. And I forgot to mention, with the moon, I have no idea what the moon is. It fascinates me. And that's one of the things that I've gotten from this research is I used to not really care about what was in the sky because, hey, it's just atoms. You know what I mean? Who cares? It's just a big ball. It doesn't really matter. Who gives a stuff? But now if I'm walking at night, I can't help but just focus on the moon. I can't stop looking at it. People must see this guy walking around with his head twisted 90 degrees, looking at the moon everywhere he walks, thinking he's some kind of fool, and maybe they're right, but I can't stop looking at the sky. I find it fascinating, and if that's all that I've gotten from this research is just refining a fascination with the world and the so-called universe that's around me, then it's been worth every second of it, and I've enjoyed this so much. So to those of you who are out there who are still desperate to hold on to the spinning ball, well, you know, maybe it's worth looking at the other side and studying their works, looking at Mark's work, looking at Jainism's work, looking at Matrix work, looking at the videos that Dearth is doing and really considering why it is that you hold on to the ball and what you get from it, because it seems to me that some of the angriest people getting around at the moment are people who really want to believe that everything started billions of years ago by chance. They just got here through millions of years of so-called evolution. They're just a speck of dust that was here for a moment, will be gone tomorrow. It doesn't really matter. And everything in the sky means nothing. And when I look at it that way, I can't blame them for being so angry and sad, because what have they got going for them? Whereas if you look at the other side, maybe, just maybe, there's more to this world than they want us to realize. And I'll wrap it up with this thought. Question everything, and especially question the people